trained in a private, wealthy hospital in Chicago for a while, and you weren't allowed to say nasty things like blood and death, because it's an upper crust hospital. And so when you're on rounds and you want to say, my God, you pull back the cover, someone's swimming in a pool of blood, you say, you know, they're quite a large quantity of heme. Heme was the word for blood. Well, you weren't supposed to say death either, but it was hard to figure out how to announce to the squad as you're going on rounds that somebody two doors down has just died, and you should all do something about it, because the hospital had this thing against not saying bad words in front of these high-class patients. You know, so we were standing at one bedside, and the other member of the squad wanted to come in and tell us that Joe Blow had croaked, had died. He was extinct. You know, he wasn't there. And he couldn't figure out how to say he died, because he weren't supposed to say it. So he sat stood at the doorway and scratched his chin, and he said, guess who doesn't shop at Woolworth's anymore? And from then on, that was how we referred to death, is guess who didn't shop at Woolworth's anymore.
How you feeling?
Hi.
You know Dr. Adams?
No, I don't think
I met last night.
He talked to you a little bit last night. You might not remember. Oh.
Yeah. One night, I got up and went downstairs, and they said that this man was in the hospital. He was supposed to die, and he had no code, no measures were supposed to be made to revive him. And there were about a half a dozen of the family members waiting outside the room, and I went in the room to pronounce him dead. And I looked at him, and he was about a 90-year-old, and went over to listen to his chest, and all of a sudden he went, I thought, oh no, now what am I going to do? These people are waiting outside for him to be dead, and he's not dead yet, and so I've got to either call a code and try and revive him, but that didn't seem right, because everybody wanted him to die. He was supposed to die at this time. And so I just sat there for about 20 minutes and watched this guy die. He was in his terminal stages of breathing, and his heart was almost not beating. But it was a very kind of quiet, almost meditative time for me to watch this man die, because everything was right. It was officially okay for him to die.
My first patient who died was a fellow who, the reason why it sticks out is because as he laid there in bed, he was sort of chronically ill, and he was at the end of his line. He had not seen physicians for years. His wife finally pulled him into the hospital. We got a hold of him. He was so sick it was impossible to tell what he was sick from. And his body was all swollen all over. His heart was failing. His kidneys were failing. We didn't know which was the cart and which was the horse. So he was laying in bed one evening when I was on call, and suddenly he got real sick real fast. And they called a code on him, and I'm going running down to him, and I reached him first, and I says, Mr. X, what's happening? And he's looking up at me, and he goes, Doctor, I'm dying. And I says, my God, here this guy is. He's alive, and he's telling me he's dying. And you can't let somebody die in UCLA, because you go before M&M rounds, and then they say, well, what happened to the guy? And you say, well, I don't know. I don't know why he was sick to begin with. So we worked like hell to get him going. And we got him going, by God, and he didn't die then. But he died 2 days later in shock. And the thing is that it brought up my own fears at that particular situation of not being aware of even what was sick with the guy. I mean, we knew what was wrong with him, but we didn't know specifically. And then when he looked in my eyes and says, I'm dying, how did I respond to that? No, you're not.
The first time I saw a dying person, it didn't move me at all. I just went like that all. So that, you know, is that all there is? And one episode I remember was they sent me out to examine a patient, and it was, interestingly enough, was a terminal cancer, and they knew a patient was going to die. It was cancer of the liver. So they parked this poor patient, in a room all by himself, and then they would just walk past his door. Now, you're supposed to do rounds twice a day. They would do rounds from the doorway, kind of like this, once a day, and, you know, then send the nurses in. You know, tell them what the blood pressure and the temperature was. Well, they sent me in because I was a medical student, and I was kind of, you know, therefore like a nurse. And I was supposed to examine the patient, and I'm listening to the lungs. and there's no breath sounds. So I busily, like a good medical student, write down markedly diminished breath sounds. And I'm finished, you know, examining this patient, everything is markedly, you know, not present. And then I turn around and discover the damn patient's dead. And I go back and tell the squad, you know, the patient's dead. And then they looked at my workup and it was like markedly diminished breath sounds, heart sounds not audible, etc. I had been examining a stiff.
I probably ignored death all the way through my medical school and residency and fellowship training. I mean, the only thing I picked up during those years was when I worked in an emergency room and somebody died, then I was sensitive enough not to just walk out and tell them. The relatives who had brought this otherwise perfectly healthy person in with acute problem, they died from a heart attack, the first heart attack at age 45 or so. I didn't go out and say, well, you know, they're dead. You know, I tried to develop some kind of technique to make it a little softer to them. That's where I basically started it, because that's where I met death most. In the medical school situation, you're blunted by, you know, attendings and residents and interns and medical students, and you're just one of a lot, and all the nurses running around. And somebody else can, you know, you can always manage to have deal with the ball. But in the emergency room situation, that's where you're put in the situation where you have to come up with some kind of an approach.
Move this leg for me.
Hey, Dave, come on, Dave. Be cool, bro.
Can you move the leg?
Come on, man.
Son of a gun.
Does this hurt up here in this part of your leg? Or on this side over here?
No. Anything under that, knock it out right here. That's all right. To the right side.
It was easy for him. It was pretty hard.
Remember the accident at all?
Sure.
Okay.
Y'all don't do it, man.
I know you hurt.
That's all right.
Wiggle your toes. What's your name?
It happens so fast. You have to go out and you face a bereaving family that is still in shock, and they don't even hear what you're saying 90% of the time. You go out and say, I'm sorry, your husband just died. And they say, Doc, he was you know, out watering the garden 15 minutes ago. How can you tell me that? I said, I'm sorry, but that's, you know, he had a massive heart attack and he died. Do you have a family physician? Do you have somebody that I can call that, you know, that can talk to you? Because you really have a difficult time counseling someone in that situation. The trauma is so great that there's very little communication that takes place. So you go on, and the emergency situation is such that right after that, you now have another 10 patients you have to see immediately. And you really have to say, okay, this is done with. I just had a patient that died. I can't dwell on that. I have to go on, and I got to see this next patient, and this next patient, and this next patient. Perhaps it's a good defense mechanism. I don't know.
I do it all intuitively. I think the process of resuscitating someone is they lie down, they come in with their compressions being made to pump their heart, and the breathing being done to sustain their breath and oxygen. And all the nurses rush in and they put the monitor in and the intravenous line and gives the drugs and all the respiratory people do the intubation.
Yes, I do.
Oh, shit. Man, you gotta remove her. Do it there.
What?
Just grabbing it for a minute.
Just for a minute.
So as a physician, all I have to do is stand back and kind of look at what's going on. Sometimes I know whether it'll be a successful resuscitation or not. And it's an intuitive kind of a thing. And once I know that it will be successful, no matter what I do, it's going to be successful. And once I sense that it's going to be unsuccessful, then I can terminate fairly rapidly with all of this foolishness and allow the person to be dead.
When do you stop cardiopulmonary resuscitation? When do you decide that enough is enough, that you have done all you can to preserve this person's life.
Because of legalities that go on medicine now, that we have to write on the chart a no code, which means that if a patient's heart stops, the nurse is duty-bound to have to start the heart again with whatever means she has available, unless the doctor writes no code. So the doctor has to say that allow this patient to die naturally, what it boils down to. Now, it's interesting to watch the generation gap in doctors, how they feel about this. The young doctor who has gone through an intensive training and worked in an intensive care unit makes a diagnosis, wants to use all the tools possible. He's going to keep going forever in general. The older doctors who are a little more aware that their end is coming, you know, not too far down the track, and they look at the patient as a whole and try to put themselves in their shoes. And it's a horrifying thought to think, well, you know, that could be me there.
Yeah.
And I would like to have the privilege of dying naturally.
Oh, now, they're crying. Yeah. How's it? Try the combination yet, and try and get some extra rest, because it's still possible.
I guess I'm an incurable optimist. I can never tell a family of a child that there is absolutely, totally no hope. And I go along with, we'll do the best we can, and I always make sure they have the optimum treatment that is known at that time for cancer. I let the parents know that at this time I don't think that we're going to make it, but it's worth a struggle keeping him alive as long as we can, just on the very off chance that some tremendous breakthrough should arrive in time.
The initial part of it is simply trying to figure out how to tell him that he's got a disease that's going to kill him. Like, okay, sir, you have cancer. Well, you don't come out and say that. You tell him, you know, you break into it over a couple, 3 or 4 days, if he has no idea what's going on. But that's just the beginning of it, because after that is when you've got to carry the ball on down. I mean, they're going to be around for another 6 months, 8 months, a year, 2 years, 3 years, nobody knows. And that's when it gets a lot harder, because a lot of things come up that I don't understand, people who are dying, interpersonal-wise. Mm-hmm. And they get grumpy at the family. They get mad at the doc, they don't want anything to do with them for a while, you know, they run off, they come back, they cause a lot of problems in the family. And then after a while, they sort of work those kind of things out and start dealing with what the problem is. What I try and do is, no matter how glum things are, I try and tell them that we got something that's going to help them. I'm not telling them I got something that's going to cure them. They may want to be cured. And they may ask me, well, will I be cured? I'll say, well, we have a chance of doing it. But, you know, after a period of time when it's obvious that they're not going to be cured, you have to move on to some other kind of hope. I'd like to, you know, give the patient as much hope as possible, because what I don't need is a depressed patient.
When I was straight out of medical school and in my internship, I couldn't tell anybody they were going to die. I kept saying, oh, I really don't think so. I think we're going to try some new medication on you. But I would never say, you know, I think you're going to die, or I think there's a real good chance you're going to die, and this medication has only a slight chance of doing this. Or even asking them, do you think you're going to die? I never thought of asking that. In my practice, after I had a few experiences like the last one I related to you, I really started asking patients. I said, how do you feel? I have to ask you this. Do you feel that you're dying? Do you feel that what this disease you have is going to kill you? I have to ask you this, because very often you have as much, if not more, information about what's going on in you than I have. And I have to understand what you're going through. And that would very often result in a tremendous outpouring of feeling from a patient that otherwise wasn't there. And then we could talk about dying after that. Often, though, if I didn't bring it up, it never was mentioned. It's sort of like the patient didn't want to disappoint me.
I think telling them the truth and tempering it with as much optimism as you can, but I think telling the truth is most important. And don't force the diagnosis on a patient if he doesn't ask for it. If he doesn't ask for it, he doesn't want it. And giving the brighter side. There's a brighter side to even an inoperable thing. And of course, nobody knows how long they're going to live. You and I don't know. And these cancer patients, they gradually accept living. They begin to worry just about the pains and the aches and the things that go on from day to day.
I had a woman. This is a fascinating thing. She had a diagnosis of a lymphoma, and it had metastasized. And she had been seen by two or three oncologists, and they had said she had about 3 or 4 months to live. She was 81 years old. And she was too weak to really be taken care of at home. She was put in a nursing home. She had been transferred from a nursing home, from a hospital in Lake Tahoe, I believe, down to where her family was closer here in Watsonville. And they called, one of the oncologists called me and asked if I would be able to take care of her as her physician in this nursing home while she was dying. I said, okay, I'd be happy to. So I saw her and told her that there was no medications really we could give her. She said, well, I feel so weak. My doc used to give me a few years ago B12 shots. I said, sure, I'll be happy to give you B12 shots. She said, fine. This woman, I saw her about every 2 weeks or so in the nursing home, and I'd come by and I'd see her, and I saw her, and I saw her, and she didn't die. And in fact, after about 6 months or so, she started gaining weight. And after a year or so, she was out of bed walking around. And 2 years later, she was running all of the bingo games and organizing the music sessions, and was the socialite of the nursing home. And we did further biopsies on these metastases that she'd had, and everything had stopped. She was no longer dying. In fact, she was now healthier than she'd been in years. And here we'd gone through this whole process of telling her and discussing with her, well, this is it, you know, 2 or 3 months. And she said, I understand, I'm fine, I think I can take that. And now she wasn't, and I had a hard time sort of coming to grips with myself how I was going to tell her, well, now you're really alive, now what are you going to do? You know, as far as I can tell, you might live another 10 years. You know, this is remarkable. And she'd just laugh. And never told me what she was really thinking at that point, except that I was probably a big fool, and those oncologists were even bigger fools. Except we kept giving her B12 shots, that was for sure. Damned if I know what good that was doing.
In fact, the older doctor will never give a time. The longer he's practiced, the less willing he is to give a time of death or a duration. You'll find no. I don't think any experienced men do that anymore at all. It's too many backlashes.
I have gone out of the prediction business. I can tell in an emergency situation when somebody is just not responding and we've done everything we can, yes, that patient is now very much dying or is dead. That's clear. Everything else is a gray zone, and I have been fooled more than once.
Okay. At work, do you ever get any problems with dizziness or lightheadedness when you switch position really quickly?
As I showed you, I'm running around just like a young girl.
I've seen you. I think put on more miles in a day than I do.
And then I sit down, then I'm in misery. I'm in misery.
What's the obvious answer to that? Never sit down?
No, I don't.
So you're
I don't. And then my feet hurt.
Probably medical training hardens your attitude towards death. It has to, because if every time somebody dies, you break down. You will be so remiss in your duties that someone else will die. You know, so you have to keep so many bodies juggled simultaneously, that you don't have time to consider death in anything but a real hard way.
You have to remind yourself. You have to keep reminding yourself that this is a person and not a case of some sort. That this isn't a pulmonary edema, or that this isn't a gunshot wound, or that this isn't a 901A victim, which is the numerical code for an automobile accident, but is really a human being. And I think you do get hardened. I think it would be impossible to continue to deal with it on a fairly regular basis unless you're able to detach yourself somewhat at times. You fluctuate. There are times when I feel as soft and mushy as anything and I can't handle it and I cry and do all that. And other times I may have two or three people die on me within a few days or experience their deaths in a week or two, and I don't even remember it. Don't even think about it twice.
I'm not sure that physicians are the best place to put the responsibility for interpreting death to families, because a lot of excellent physicians are no way able to do that, and yet they're superb physicians. There are other people who are very good at doing that, and they're crummy physicians. So the personality of the doc, I don't think should be considered a very important factor, because the most important factor is, can the damn physician, does he know enough or she know enough to be able to snatch defeat from, snatch victory from the jaws of defeat? You know, the bright physician is the one who can balance and manage and keep someone walking a tight line and out of the grave.
That was a very emotional time for me. This was a young mother who was divorced from her husband, and she was involved in an auto accident. And she had a baby that was somewhere between 6 months and a year old, and the baby was killed in the accident, and she had a number of fractures. And she was in the intensive care unit, and for the first day or two after a serious accident like this, a patient is usually so concerned with what's happened to them that it's not appropriate to tell them of the loss of a child like this. And so I decided to wait until she would ask and that she was oriented and alert enough to talk to her about it, and then I would go in and talk to her. And 2 days after she was in the hospital, she was in traction, and then she started asking specific questions about her child and what had happened. And so I went in the hospital to tell her about it, and just as I got there, her general practitioner was telling her that her baby had died, and she just screamed out, just a horrible scream, and just fell apart, just a real immediate emotional response, which was perfectly normal, and it was something that I could ordinarily deal with. But the baby was exactly the same age as my boy, and so I just did an about face and walked out the room and sat down in the nursing station, and I was kind of collecting myself because it was very emotional, made tears come to my eye and so forth, and one of the nurses came in and she said, that baby was the same age as yours, wasn't it? Well, I think doctors become very good at being able to deal with things up to the point that they feel comfortable, and they develop good defense mechanisms to get out of going any further if they're uncomfortable. Some situations are very difficult. For me, it's in situations when I can identify with it, because if a baby dies that's the same age as my own child, I get so much empathy for the parents of that baby that it's difficult for me to deal with it without becoming very emotional. And to maintain a professional attitude and to maintain a position of strength so that I can help them, it gets difficult, and oftentimes you call in help.
just a few months ago, I was told I had a tumor, and I went and looked it all up, and it turned out to be a bad one. If you're the 2 out of 100, you know, for 2% of people, this particular tumor is a wipeout, and for 98%, you live forever, happily ever after. So, out of paranoia, I started thinking I was among the 2%. And, when you really think you might be dying, that's completely different. And that's different from surviving dying, and that's different from being a surviving family member, and that's different from being a physician. That puts you in a whole new category where you're not really on this earth anymore, or you're not really on it in the same way everybody else is. Everything looks different. Sunny days look different. Going out for a ride looks different. Working is different. Everything is different when you think you might be dying, you might die. Everything. It's just incredible, you know, what it does to what you assume are normal human feelings. You know, it's just a different ballgame. All I thought of, for example, is I didn't want to go jogging anymore. You know, and that's my biggest kick in life for the last 11 years. It's, you know, whoopee. But all of a sudden, I figure, why bother? You know, why whip anything into shape anymore? And at first, I thought, well, I guess the best thing to do is just keep on working as if nothing had happened. Just keep on going day by day, just like every day. You know, what's the big deal? You know, why race around the globe and see all there is to see? And then you don't know what to do. You just don't know how to spend your days. You just really don't know how to do it. So you cry a lot and put a lot of demands on the people around you. And so I tell patients that, at least these two patients I've told, you know, I've had a tumor too, and I, just so that if they feel like breaking down, you know, they're in the office, it's all, you know, it's okay, you know, I won't go running the other way. Mm-hmm. But I just wish someone would come back from the beyond and tell us what was there, for God's sake, and, you know, settle all this stuff. This is, you know, this kind of craziness that occurs with having to face death is, you know, if they would only come back, you know, or a skywrite or something. You know.